Not only to foreigners throughout the world has Bond succeeded in promoting a seductive ideal of what it means to be British. He has done this most effectively to the British themselves. When we required an ambassador to represent us at the opening of the 2012 London Olympics, who did we pluck from the heavens to act as the Queen's bodyguard in a cameo appearance watched by an estimated 1 billion people, but the one other Britisher to have enjoyed Her Majesty's fame? She had attended not a few of his premieres as well. James Bond has evolved into an immaculate agent of escapism. The lower the sun has sunk on the empire that Bond was born into, the more radiant his glow. But what of his creator? Rendered into tabloid fat as a card-playing golfer, fortified on a diet of martinis, Turkish tobacco and scrambled eggs, tiptoeing, slip-on shoes in hand, up the narrow staircase in Victoria Square, past wife Anne's smart guests, to his monastic top-floor bedroom, where, after first removing his polka-dotted bow tie and navy blue Sea Island cotton shirt, he would lie with his blanket over his head, listening to over-educated voices on the floor below, snigger at his latest book. This caricature still broadly holds. However, after considerable research under the jarring surface of his popular image, emerged a different person. About his early years, Ian talked as sparingly as James Bond. Bond never says to his companion, "This is where I first learned to ride a bicycle." Like the stamps and cigarette cards Ian collected as a boy, the story of his childhood has to be assembled from disparate sources. It was a privileged upbringing, overprivileged even. The second of four sons, Ian was sent to Kitzbühel in the Austrian Tyrol, where a small number of adolescent boys were coached in French and German, and the tutors were gaining a reputation for knowing how to handle delinquent children. His tutor, Ernan Forbes Dennis, who afterwards became a professional analyst, was mystified by Fleming's attitude towards his early years, the sense of deprivation which lasted all through his life. This puzzled Fleming's school friends. He had everything he could have wanted, looks, money, brains, position, but he behaved as if he was permanently deprived. Ian was a son of wealth, but the grandson of poverty. His grandfather, Robert, grew up in a two-roomed rented cottage west of Dundee. Still, Robert managed in one generation to be one of the wealthiest men in Europe. "Ian used to get very sullen towards Christmas," said his wife, Anne. "Apparently, as a boy, he had always hated going to Black Mount in Argyllshire for the traditional deer-hunting thing with the Flemings. Felt claustrophobia in the family circle." "I don't like hunting or shooting," Ian wrote to Anne. Putting his father Valentine's stalking glass to the eye, there is a tempting explanation for Ian's stormy childhood. What he had been starved of, what had fed his melancholy, was his mother Eve's undivided love at a time when Ian needed it most. His elder brother's illness had dictated Ian's first years. At the moment Ian was born, Eve's focus was wrenched from him when Peter contracted colitis. In a state of permanent concern, the Flemings travelled to Lausanne over four successive years for Peter to undergo treatment under the supervision of a Swiss specialist. All this attention on his delicate brother proved too much for Ian, who, age five, made a great scene and had to be carried screaming and kicking from the Beau Rivage Hotel. His screaming and kicking did not subside either. Val Fleming had joined his father, Robert's bank, as a partner in 1909. The following year, he stood for Parliament. On his election, the family moved to Pitt House on Hampstead Heath, a grey 12-bedroomed house with a billiard room, two tennis courts, and a 4-acre garden overspilling with rhododendrons. Eve at once built for herself the most original music room, the walls of which are covered with moonlight blue glass, according to Vogue. Here she practised her violin, while her husband played at being a constituency MP. "Val was absolutely a non-politician," said Peter. His friend Churchill observed that the fierce tumults that swayed political life were not for Val. 8 months later, the country went to war. Val's was the first territorial unit to see action. He and his brother, Philip, would be in France together on and off for 3 years. Val single-handedly put out the flames on a lorry loaded with ammunition exploding in all directions. Twice mentioned in dispatches, his code was "Leave no man behind." When one of his men was badly shot in the shoulder, Val crawled out in broad daylight and had him bandaged. Then, wrote Philip, even though they were quite exposed to the Germans, his brother carried the man back to the place where the doctor was, behind the line. On the 20th of May 1917, his luck ran out. Val had gone with his squadron to take over Guillemont Farm, a forward post opposite the Hindenburg line. At 2:30 in the morning, a heavy bombardment started up when he was hit in the back by a big piece of shell, according to the regimental chaplain. Already cast as the difficult one, Ian took the blow of Val's death hard. It was not merely that he had to live up to his father's standards. Ian was at the martyred mercy of his histrionic widowed mother and her insecurities and extravagant, often punitive, whims. It alarmed a friend to see how Eve used any sort of blackmail to get her way with the boys. "Your father's spirit has spoken to me," she'd say when particularly keen on getting them to do something they didn't want to. Another friend who came to know Ian in the 1930s recognised how he was enormously affected by the death of his father. This was one of the original sources of his melancholy. On top of everything, it threw out of kilter his fox-cub relationship with brother Peter, who had been told by Eve, "You are responsible now." No father, Eve in control, holding the purse strings, Peter second in command. If there was a moment when the mould set, it was May 1917. Like Peter Pan, part of Ian remained frozen at the age of 8. Eton College, founded in 1440 by Henry VI on the edge of Windsor, principally for the education of 70 poor boys, had a view of the royal castle across the Thames. Boys generally stayed for 5 years. In many cases, they were marked, as Ian was, for life. Anne heard how, on his first night at Eton, the housemaster, a tyrant and a bully, came in and said, "I'm going to break you, Fleming." When Ian took the American novelist Paul Gallico to his old room, Gallico thought Ian was going to be sick. "I was desperately unhappy," Ian told another friend. "Away from the hours I spent on the playing field, I hated the place." However, Ian's emotional connection to the school ran deep. He put his own son, Casper, down for Eton. The school's most observable legacy was the company he kept in this life. Eton introduced Ian to the narrow group of people who ran his world, an exclusive club that had an impact, out of all proportion to its numbers, on every aspect of British society, forming networks as deep and pervasive as Japanese knotweed. As well, Eton furnished Ian with names for his fiction. Two sets of brothers were the Chitties, A.M. Chitty and J.T. Chitty, sons of the college chaplain. Chitty Chitty Bang Bang was the children's novel Ian wrote for his son, and G.A. Scaramanga Major and T.A. Scaramanga Minor, Scaramanga being the three-nippled assassin in The Man with the Golden Gun. Somewhat to his irritation, Boofy Gore found himself recast as a minor Bond villain, Boofy Kid. Mr. Big's battered black top hat from Live and Let Die has suspicious Etonian contours, as does Oddjob's lethal bowler from Goldfinger. Boys wore bowlers at puppy shows for the school's beagles. Probably the most famous Etonian reincarnation is the head of the criminal syndicate, Spectre. Thomas Robert Blofeld had been taken away from Eton with mastoids 2 years before Ian's arrival. But Ian, on meeting his son Henry at Boodle's in 1960, explained how he had needed an evil name and could not think of one. Henry says, "One morning he went to Boodle's, sank into a leather chair and grabbed the club membership list and got a B, and gobsmacked by three Blofelds,
slammed the book shut, gave a yelp of delight, and ordered a pewter mug of champagne and never looked back. Ian arrived at Eton a year after Peter, in September 1921, aged 13. He would leave a term before him, in April 1926. His only triumph over his brother, said friend Mary Pakenham, was his height. Peter, being under the required height of 5'4", still had to wear a bum freezer jacket. Ian wore tailcoats from the start. The Fleming room in their house, the Timbrels, is a tribute to this fraternal struggle and the topsy-turvydom of fame. Today, boys in the house associate the Fleming name exclusively with the Bond author. Yet had you mentioned the name Fleming in this room at any time between the 1920s and the 1950s, the talked-about author would have been Peter. He was, says one of Peter's successors as literary editor of The Spectator, one of the most famous Etonians there's ever been. Peter won the Duke of Newcastle's Spanish and the King's French prizes. He became house captain, then captain of the Oppidans. He acted in The Devil's Disciple and, most memorably, in Androcles. He was no mean sportsman either. However much Ian admitted to hero-worshipping his brother, it crushed him to be in Peter's accomplished academic and dramatic shadow. Ian looked like a black sheep, whatever he did. His solution was to find an identity that emphasised their differences. As Mary Pakenham saw it, the gooder Peter became, the naughtier Ian would have to become. Ian received many white tickets for bad work. On top of his undistinguished academic achievement, another concern of his mother's was Ian's frivolous extracurricular life. Ian's letter to Eve expresses contrition for many lapses. Ian did have one piece of news to cheer his mother. "I am up to being taught by an absolutely ripping lush this half-term called Littleton. He's extraordinarily nice, and the whole div, class, adores him because he understands you so well, and you feel that you want to do your best up to him." Ian was fortunate to be up to George Littleton. One of the more outstanding English schoolmasters of his generation, he later singled out those extra studies chaps he was proud to have taught. Aldous Huxley, Jack Haldane, John Layman, George Orwell, Cyril Connolly, Alan Price Jones, and Peter Fleming. He made this list in the late 1950s in a letter to another former pupil, Rupert Hart Davis. Significant is the name he leaves out. In the same correspondence, Littleton writes how he is reading Ian Fleming's Moonraker on Hart Davis's recommendation. "It thrilled me. IF must be a devilishly clever fellow. I must get hold of his other novels. I wonder why I never came across him at Eton." Fleming Minor had made no impression on his favourite teacher. All through his youth, he had been in disgrace for one thing or another, said friend and columnist Mary Pakenham, daughter of the Earl of Longford. So walking down the street in the uniform of a naval commander must have been absolute bliss. Ian arrived at 6:30 a.m. He entered the smoke-grimed Admiralty building from a door at the start of the Mall, stepping into a small Georgian hallway with a statue of Nelson in a niche, and a one-armed doorman in a frock coat who, though pleased to see him, was adamant about inspecting his pass. A long white corridor and a stone floor of coloured mosaic led to the lobby outside Ian's office. Messengers, tea-ladies and chars with mops and pails huddled round the coal fire. There was a joke that the tea-trolley, which clanked its way round, was the only serviceable tank in the British Army. Opposite, the black door with 39 painted in white opened into a noisy room, hazy with tobacco smoke and bustling with men and women telephoning, arguing, writing, typing. By the end of 1942, there were 24 people in this never-empty cave, as Ian's boss, Director of Naval Intelligence, Admiral Godfrey, called it. Ian felt a round peg in a round hole from the moment he sat down at his desk. mentor and confidant Maud Russell reported that he loves his NID better than anything he has ever done, I think, except skiing. Ian's last duty in room 39, following VJ Day, was to sign a pledge never to reveal what he had done there. All his wartime colleagues in naval intelligence took these ordinances seriously. It was the custom for many years to deride Ian as a chocolate sailor, after a Hershey's advertisement in the late 1930s, suggesting he was little more than a desk-bound pen pusher, so contemporaries like Ian Gilmore believed. All he commanded was in-trays, out-trays and ashtrays. Any idea that Ian Fleming preferred to sit out the war at his desk does not represent the truth. He took part in operations in Paris and Bordeaux, even as France was falling apart. He volunteered to crash-land a Heinkel bomber into the Channel and be dropped by submarine on the Frisian island of Borkum to monitor U-boat movements. Godfrey vetoed all these plans. It would have meant breaking one of the basic rules. No one on the ultra list should risk falling into enemy hands. Not James Bond, not the Joint Intelligence Committee chair, not even Churchill's confidential advisor on intelligence were in the charmed circle that had ultra clearance. Christopher Moran is a professor of US national security who specializes in Fleming's Secret Service work. He says, Ian Fleming was unique. He knew it all, as a spy chief should. In July 1940, Ian was handpicked to impress on Colonel Wild Bill Donovan, President Roosevelt's special representative when he visited London, that Britain was a fighter that stood a chance and was worth supporting. They met later in Gibraltar, where Ian's task was to persuade Wild Bill to make Britain's fight America's fight too, and he was closely linked with Bill Stevenson and others who helped bring America on board. An early memorandum Ian prepared for Admiral Godfrey was the notorious Trout Memo, circulated to service intelligence chiefs, containing suggestions for introducing ideas into the heads of the Germans. Many of these ideas bore Ian's stamp, and included a fake treasure ship packed with commandos, or sending out false information through bogus copies of the Times. Idea number 28 on the list was based on a novel in Ian's library written by an old Etonian spycatcher who had recently died. A corpse dressed as an airman with dispatches in his pockets could be dropped on the coast, supposedly from a parachute that had failed. This idea formed the kernel for Operation Mincemeat, the successful deception operation which occurred off the coast of Spain in April 1943, with the posthumous recreation of the tramp Glendore Michael into Major William Martin of the Royal Marines, whose body was washed ashore near Cadiz with apparent top-level plans designed to disguise the Allies' invasion of Sicily. Ian's success at drafting memos like this and implicating Churchill convincingly encouraged Godfrey to expand his duties and throw on him full power and responsibility. Ian proposed a radical scheme, a specialist commando unit trained and staffed by naval intelligence to capture intelligence material in the course of raids on the enemy coastline. "Have you ever heard of 30 AU? Ian asked expert topographer Robert Harling. "Never." "Well, it's sure for number 30 Assault Unit. Basically, the unit's job is to seize enemy equipment, ciphers, scientific know-how before such material can be destroyed." He wanted Harling to join. 30 AU emulated the clan system of Ian Fleming's forebears, says Nicholas Rankin, author of The History of the Unit. They were like border raiders going to steal English cattle from Scottish bases. The pressing need for a breakthrough in cracking German naval enigma traffic triggered the formation of 30 AU. Ian's unit will grow from 24 men in 1942 to 450 in 1945. The unit was always hedged by secrecy. One of its last survivors, Bill Marshall, age 94, says, "A did not know B, and B did not know X. No one knew. Afterwards, when I put my number into the government website, up came, 'This person does not exist.' The Admiralty said my records won't be released till 2050. Some of them." The officers that Ian selected for his intelligence assault unit were a remarkable bunch. Sancho Glanville, a special operations agent doubling as vice consul in Zagreb, went on to write the internal history of the NID. He was a butterfly collector who, after landing at Juno Beach in June 1944, exclaimed,
"Look, a black-veined white. You don't see many of those at home."
The eventual action head of 30 AU was Ian's decorated Eton contemporary Dunstan Curtis, DSC, a lawyer and linguist who, in March 1942, had captained the lead boat into Saint-Nazaire in Operation Chariot. Ian made it a requirement that the officers speak German and one other language. When Patrick Martin Smith captured an Italian admiral and his wife on Capri in July 1943, the admiral's wife kept referring to Martin Smith as "this charming young Rhinelander," under the impression that a German officer was removing her. The officers would have specialist knowledge, be given specific targets, and were to be protected at all times by Royal Marines assigned to the unit. One of Ian's unorthodox requirements was that the men should be encouraged to read novels and books on intelligence work. Ian had thought out a lot of the training for Operation Torch, the Allied invasion of French North Africa, in November 1942. Bill Marshall says, "I was taught how to throttle and use a knife and was trained in explosives, plus how to blow open safes, handle mortars, mines and booby traps. There was even a course to inspect a captured German submarine, U-570, boarding at night to find a way into the cipher room. Dunstan Curtis was put in charge of the unit for Torch. Curtis and his 30 commando landed in the dunes 12 miles west of Algiers after coming under shellfire from the Vichy Navy. Prior to this, Curtis and Fleming had locked horns, yet Curtis said, "I was astonished at how much he knew about Algiers, how extremely detailed his intelligence was, and how much thought he had given to our whole show, including air pictures and models." For Torch, Ian had supplied Curtis with a very detailed shopping list. The best catch was for ciphers, anything marked Geheim, secret, magnetic mines, the latest torpedo, and so on. In a hilltop villa, Curtis discovered an Italian codebook in the pocket of an abandoned greatcoat. His most precious find was a modified Enigma machine. Unknowingly captured by the Americans in the Hotel Aleti, the cipher machine had been tossed in the back of an American vehicle and was considered unimportant. Recognising at once what it was, Curtis promptly removed it for safekeeping. He arranged for it to be flown as a priority back to Bletchley. The KK rewired turnover Abwehr machine allowed Dilly Knox, Margaret Rock and Mavis Beatty to break 6 weeks of unread Abwehr traffic. This pinch alone, in Nicholas Rankin's assessment, completely vindicated the IAU's existence. By December, the four-rotor Enigma was broken. A paragraph that Ian deleted from Russia with Love hints at the crown jewels the coders at Bletchley hoped for. "All the accumulated traffic that they had intercepted since the war, millions of words of it, that was at present unreadable and useless, would now yield its fabulous secrets. In a matter of weeks, they would know all the high policy of past years, state secrets of every description, the innermost workings of the MGB and GRU, naval military and air strengths and orders of battle, everything that Russia had wanted to hide from the West. It was fantastic, incredible. A defeat it would take Russia decades to recover from. For Russia, read Nazi Germany." Just days before the formal surrender of the German Navy in Kiel, Ian, in Paris, had climbed into a staff car with an Admiralty chauffeur, plus two Marines in a naval patrol car as bodyguards, and was driven at top speed on a 400-mile journey across France, deep into southern Germany. Ian's small convoy pulled into the courtyard of a converted monastery in Lower Bavaria, ahead of the Russians. Sancho Glanville and a small 30 AU field team had taken possession of extensive documents at Tambach, which in Glanville's words were the most closely guarded secrets of the German Navy. Glanville had composed an urgent signal to Ian, emphasising the need to move quickly to avoid the possibility of the archive falling into Russian hands. This was why Ian had risked driving into the heart of the battle zone. The snapping up of this unique archive, which made it possible to find out how much the enemy had discovered about our secrets, had its origins in Ian's library of technical breakthroughs. Rarely, if ever, can any country have captured so much of another country's past, was Nicholas Rankin's assessment in Ian Fleming's Commandos. He still smoked 70 cigarettes a day. The night duty officer at NID complained about the amount of cigarette ash on the floor. But throughout his time at the Admiralty, Ian had commanded a great deal more than in-trays, out-trays and ashtrays. The Ian Fleming who walked out of room 39 after 6 years at the Admiralty had gained tremendously in stature. In the same way, the war had transformed the ordinary man, wrote the war correspondent Alan Moorhead. You could almost watch him grow from month to month in the early days. He was suddenly projected out of a shallow and materialist world into an atmosphere where there really were possibilities of touching the heights. And here and there, a man found greatness in himself. This had been Ian's experience. He had felt that what he was doing was a clear and definite good, the best he could do. As in Moorhead's description, he was, for a moment of time, a complete man, and he had this sublimity in him. Ian never lived at such an intense level again. He would spend the rest of his life in peacetime, trying to recapture moments of time like these. The way he did that was by writing the books which have become the reason we are still reading about him today. In the last months of the war, Lord Kemsley had pressed Ian to join the Kemsley Newspapers Group, which owned the Sunday Times, Sunday Graphic and Daily Sketch. After some tough negotiating, Ian had signed a contract. The ambitious press lord was keen to inject into his newspaper chain the flair for reorganisation and zip Ian was rumoured to have brought to Room 39, Ian's office at the Naval Intelligence Gathering Unit during the war. Kemsley's clinching offer was for Ian to start a foreign news service as a rival to Reuters to be shared by all his papers. Ian set out his conditions. No editorial interference. Salary of £4,500 and £500 expenses, approximately £255,000 today. And an ironclad annual holiday. 2 months paid leave so he could winter in Jamaica. 15 years later, Kemsley made an unexpected sale of the Sunday Times. Robert Harling, one of Ian's first hirings, observed how Kemsley derived a curious latter-day pride from recalling the eccentric contract he had granted Fleming with those curious holiday arrangements, that those spells in Jamaica ultimately contributed substantially to the emergence of Bond was undoubtedly true. This was Ian's conviction. Would these books have been born if I had not been living in the gorgeous vacuum of a Jamaican holiday? I doubt it. The idea for Bond came to him as he swam in his bay in Jamaica. His midlife crisis had occurred at a decisive moment. In the same month that his lover, Anne, left her husband, Esmond Rothermere, Winston Churchill was re-elected Prime Minister, following 6 years of Clement Attlee's Labour government. Then, on the 6th of February 1952, days after Ian and Anne arrived at Goldeneye, Ian's house in Jamaica, George VI unexpectedly died. A new Elizabethan age was how Kemsley newspapers heralded the young Queen's reign. For Ian, the announcement of a period of royal mourning could not have been more timely.
My mental hands were empty, and I was just about to get married, which is a terrible step to take at the age of 43.
Suddenly, as he floated over the reef, above Barracuda he had named after battleships, Ian saw an exhilarating path back to bachelorhood. By creating a contemporary naval hero in the tradition of Drake, Morgan and Nelson, loyal to the crown, who would reaffirm England as a world power and re-establish SIS as the most dangerous secret service in Russian eyes. And he would be a bachelor. Ian's Cold War offspring emerged from his decision to reach back, not forward, and explore the path he might have taken. Consciously moulding his hero in opposition to marriage, Ian set about to retrieve the epoch in which he had thrived, young, single, and free. Ian was a fiction writer during the last fifth of his life, but he had nursed literary ambitions since Eton. His aspiration to write a serious novel, confessed to Selby Armitage in 1928, had been coloured by his readings of William Plomer, Alfred Adler, Leo Perutz, Thomas Mann and James Joyce. None of these influences were noted in reviews of the Bond books. So how did Ian's highbrow European novel turn into Casino Royale? By 1952, Ian was hemmed in on all sides by novelists who had used him or his material for their fiction. When she stayed at Goldeneye in 1947, writer and former tutor in Austria, Phyllis Bottom, had given him her new spy thriller, The Lifeline, with its old Etonian protagonist modelled on Ian. In 1949, Alaric Jacob published his fictionalised memoir Scenes from a Bourgeois Life, featuring Ian as Hugo Dropmore. It annoyed Ian to witness the reception of Duff Cooper's Operation Heartbreak, 1950, a fictionalised account of Operation Mincemeat that had originated in an idea of Ian's. The tinder was there. His parched grasses awaited only the spark. His elder brother provided it, says Ian's niece, Jilly. Peter and Ian had a bet. Peter was writing away. He took himself very seriously, listened to himself on the radio, thought he sounded a stupid man, poured scorn on himself, wanting people to cheer him up and say, "You're wonderful." Ian said, "Oh, for God's sake, write a bestseller, why don't you?" "Peter, it's not that easy. Ian, I bet you £100 I could do it." And the bet was honoured. Ian got paid by Peter £100. All Flemings have to win. Anne's diary fragment is undated. "This morning Ian started to type a book. Very good thing. He says he cannot be idle while I screw up my face trying to draw fish." She liked collecting fish out of a net, bringing them on shore and painting them. While she painted, Ian put on goggles and flippers and went swimming. On or around the 17th of February 1952, he sat down at his red bulletwood desk. "I'd finished killing fish. I knew the sand and rocks of the underwater terrain like my own garden. Only sharks or barracuda or something just as nasty were targets for the spear gun now. So I decided that it was now I should start killing a few humans. On paper, anyway." He rolled a sheet of foolscap into his battered royal portable typewriter that had seen him through Room 39, cast his mind back to the French coastal resort where he had met Anne, and began tapping out what she believed was the magnum opus that she'd been badgering him to get on with for years. On his return to England, Ian explained to his friend Maud Russell, "I was in a terrible state and appalled at the thought of getting married. I sat down at the typewriter and typed 2,000 words every day till I'd finished. I didn't reread or correct it, and I didn't show it to Anne. When I got back, I told William Plomer at Jonathan Cape Publishers what I'd done, and he asked to see it." It is instructive that Ian began writing Bond after going diving. A glimpse into how Ian approached thriller writing is his advice to Sunday Times readers on how to emulate Jacques Cousteau. "On holiday this summer, round the shores of England, it would be worth going to the local carpenter and getting him to putty a pane of glass into the bottom of a 2-foot square box, about 1 foot deep, make the whole thing watertight, and cut a couple of handholes near the top of two sides. Then all that is necessary is to walk into the sea within your depth and put the box on the surface of the sea and look through it. There, waiting for you, is a new world crammed with treasure and beauty and excitement."
from that first moment to goggles and aqualungs and sunken galleys is just turning the pages of the most exciting book that has been given to us since we learnt to fly, the Book of the Sea.
Cousteau had democratised the sea. Ian made the Secret Service available to all. His James Bond was a professional agent shorn of personal details who served as a modern, aspirational everyman. Ian gave his readers license to imagine themselves in Bond's shoes, in his car, in his bed, navigating the post-war world and its challenges with the aplomb of one of the elite. Some readers identified with Ian's hero so closely they fancied themselves to have been his model. 4 months after Ian's death, Anne wrote to Evelyn Waugh, "Nothing on the breakfast tray but people who think they are James Bond or want to be James Bond." Was there an original? The Ceaseless Search illustrates how we never seem satisfied to take people at their word. Ian never made any secret that Bond was a fictional compound of the agents and commando types he had met during the Second World War, a medley of himself and what he had asked others to do or heard they had done. More than anything, Bond was the solution to Ian's quandary. Ian wrote his thriller to overcome a cluster of frustrations, with newspaper editor Kemsley, the State of England, SIS, and the loss of his personal freedom after Anne looked set, like a Wallace Simpson, to remove him from his bachelor's throne. Add to that the lesion of Ian's unacknowledged war record. As Robert Harling said, "I think he was a little piqued that he got no decoration at the end of it." Harling worked more closely with Ian than almost anyone. In Room 39, No. 30 Assault Unit, at the Sunday Times, the Queen Anne Press, and on the Book Collector. The truth, of course, was and is that Bond was a Fleming alter ego, rescued from the dream world of his boyhood and early manhood. Ian's models were made early on. His father, Val's heroism in the First World War, contributed as much to Bond's makeup as did Peter's record in the Second, which, like Ian's, was strangely unsung. If there was anyone who set the bar for understated courage, a commando before commandos were formed, it was Ian's brother. In what were to be his last words on the subject, Ian still struggled for a coherent answer.
"Some of the quirks and characteristics that I give Bond are ones that I know about. When I make him smoke certain cigarettes or drink a certain bourbon, it's because I do so myself and I know what it tastes like. But, of course, James Bond is a highly romanticised version of anybody, let alone myself. And I certainly couldn't keep up with him. I couldn't even at his age, which is and always has been in the middle 30s.
The secret that Ian discovered through Bond was how to unscramble the code for narrative.
"There is only one recipe for a bestseller, and it is a very simple one. You have to get the reader to turn over the page." "How do you do it?"
Plomer wanted to know.
"I believe you could create extreme anxiety out of a cake-judging competition at a women's institute."
In Jamaica, Ian followed a timetable as strict as Bond's training exercises. Nobody could interrupt it.
"I work about 3 hours in the morning and 1 hour in the evening, and I find unless I stick to a routine, if I just wait for genius to arrive from the skies, it just doesn't arrive."
It is difficult to be simple. Style is also a projection of personality. Efficient, spare, masculine, austere. His plain writing had been influenced by his training with Reuters,
where you damn well had to be neat and correct and concise and vivid.
Short sentences, no unnecessary adverbs, fast and journalistic, like Hemingway. Ian had told a colleague in Room 39 that
"the great thing is to get something down. Get it started. Think, to begin with, most carefully about Chapter 1, because when you have got that finished, you will find yourself in a groove, and incidents and conversations and brilliant reflections will come flooding back."
The opening sentence is therefore of great importance. Once Ian began, it raced along, because most of the plot was there, coiled up inside him, like a contained bond, waiting to be released. He did not have to invent from scratch. He was someone who needed to have seen and smelled what he wrote about, the places, the people who sparked his characters that emerged fully formed, to have involved himself in their situations. Plus, he had a deadline.
The scent and smoke and sweat of a casino are nauseating at 3 a.m.
He was back in the French town where he first met Anne, in the casino where he had gambled in the last month before the war. Ian finished writing his stark little melodrama on the 18th of March 1952. He married Anne a week later. From 1952 to 1955, Ian had published 3 Bond novels. In total, he had earned less than £2,000. What saved Bond was the Suez Crisis. In the autumn of 1956, without telling the Americans, Anthony Eden joined with the French and Israelis in sending a task force to retake the canal which Egypt's president had nationalized in July. Over 3 intense weeks, all attention was fixed on an invalid British Prime Minister who escaped in the catastrophic aftermath to convalesce in the place where Ian Fleming had conceived James Bond 4 years earlier. The point of Eden's going to Goldeneye was to recuperate. But instead of taking his rest, he insisted on continuing to run the country from the 2 white telephones and teleprinter that Jamaica's governor, Sir Hugh Foote, had hurriedly installed. High on amphetamines, Eden presided over the dying convulsion of British imperialism from Ian's modest lookout. The damage to British prestige and the nation's self-worth cannot be understated. Eden had taken over the premiership from Churchill in April 1955, when Britain was still considered one of the 3 post-war powers. By the time he returned to London, his actions have reduced that number to 2. Strangely, the effect on Ian would be the opposite. For Ian, the benefit of Eden's visit to Goldeneye was incalculable. What instantly made it so was Beaverbrook's offer to serialise the new Bond novel in The Express and capitalise on the publicity that linked the Prime Minister and Ian Fleming to the island where Beaverbrook himself had a home. Months later, The Express began also carrying a strip cartoon of James Bond. This double exposure added considerably to Ian's sales among lower middle class readers, who had been at the heart of popular support for Eden's invasion. For the first time since he started writing, and right at the moment when he had been tempted to do away with Bond, Ian looked like breaking through the sound barrier that had eluded him in his previous 4 novels. The moment that locked Ian Fleming inescapably to his legend occurred at a dinner party in Washington in March 1960. The bones of the story are well known. On the weekend of the 11th and 12th of March, as the Kennedy election campaign gathered pace, Ian came to stay with his newspaper's Washington correspondent, Henry Brandon. Ian's friend, Otsie Leiter, was having dinner with the Kennedys and rang up to ask if she could bring Ian along. Otsie described Kennedy's response in 2 versions, confirming how entangled Fleming and his creation had become. In the first version, eyes sparkling,
"James Bond."
In the second,
Jack said, "You don't mean the Ian Fleming?" And I said, "Yes." Jack said, "Jackie, have him for dinner tonight." So we went.
Bond was the sort Kennedy admired, a sexy public servant protected by the state and yet sanctioned to do unstatesmanlike things in the line of duty. The Second World War, in which Kennedy had served, was a period when the fate of nations hinged on unconventional individuals. Ian probably knew from Otsie that a senator friend of hers was a fan, considering how focused Ian was on getting his books to influential readers, but he could hardly have imagined that Bond would soon become accepted, in biographer John Pearson's description, as the resident Superman of the new frontier, and a shorthand for a new vision of masculinity, which Jack Kennedy epitomised. At 7:30 p.m, Oatsy, wearing a black and red Givenchy dress, turned up with Ian at 3307 North Street and pressed the bell. Six others were present that evening. Jack and Jackie, the expressionist painter Bill Walton and his wife, John Bross, senior planner at the CIA, and another Bond fan, and the influential Washington Post columnist Joe Alsop, who championed Jack Kennedy to his 25 million readers in the upcoming November election. This was the top table. With his eye for the main chance, Ian knew this was his moment to seize. He prepared to put his considerable charisma to work.
"The rapport was instantaneous," said Oatsy. "Jack was mesmerised by Ian, like a child. From the moment he met him, he couldn't have been more thrilled if he had met a top Hollywood star."
About that March evening on North Street, Ian was discreet in remembering that
"the Kennedys did say they were excited about James Bond, but we really didn't talk much about books, mostly about world affairs."
Meal over, they filed into the drawing room, where, said Oatsy, the discussion returned to the vexing topic of Fidel Castro. Cuba was just becoming one of the subjects everyone in Washington was beginning to worry about, and there had been a certain amount of what's-to-be-done talk over dinner. Jack looked at Ian as if he might know the answer.
"What would Bond do?"
he asked. What would Bond do? The question from the man who would be president. Oatsy watched as Fleming took over. She said,
"Ian began talking in that wonderfully casual, slightly bored voice of his. I really don't see what all the fuss is about. Why is this fellow Castro such a problem? You're just making an international figure out of him, by the very importance you seem to attach to him, instead of which it could be all so simple."
"How, Ian?" asked Kennedy.
"Well, there's one weapon you should use, but which none of you seem to have thought of."
"What?"
"Ridicule. Instead of making him look important to the Cubans, set out to make him look ridiculous." And for the next 20 minutes, Ian did an impromptu monologue on the Fleming three-point plan for ridiculing Castro.
Ian told Kennedy that the three things Cubans love most were money, religion, and sex. He proposed the following. 1. A high-altitude aircraft to shower forged Cuban pesos over Havana as a goodwill gesture. This would destabilize the currency. 2. The projection of a gigantic cross into the night sky from America's base in Guantanamo. This would force Cubans to look skyward and make them believe the Second Coming was at hand. 3. An aircraft to drop pamphlets purportedly from a Swiss sex institute, with photographs of bearded Cubans, plus information that fallout from US nuclear tests in the area had proved that radioactivity settled for the longest periods in men's facial hair, and they will become impotent. The Barbudos would shave off their beards, and the revolution would be over.
"Everyone roared with laughter," said Oatsy, "and Jack ended up almost with tears in his eyes. It was a tour de force of brilliance and wit and very, very funny."
Ian's proposals were actually close to ideas developed by the CIA. This should not surprise, given his intelligence background. Missing from the record is whether Ian also mooted an assassination attempt on Castro.
"Assassination may be the only means left of overthrowing a modern tyrant,"
Alan Dulles, CIA director at the time of Suez, had told the New York Bar Association on the 20th of June 1947. Dulles was no less susceptible to the Bond model as an operative fantasy than Kennedy. Weeks before Oatsy took Ian to dinner with Kennedy, Dulles dined with Ian at the London offices of MI6.
"We had quite a night of it. Fleming was a brilliant talker, with ideas on everything. Before we got through, we had pretty well torn orthodox intelligence to pieces. We talked of new tools that would have to be invented for the new era."
Dulles turned out to be as gadget-minded as Fleming. Isvestia reported how, following their dinner, Dulles even attempted, but unsuccessfully, to try out in the CIA laboratories the methods recommended by Fleming in his books, including a spring-tipped, poison-tipped dagger shoe. The CIA chief had found the author even more impressive in the flesh than in his books. "Ever since that night, I kept in constant touch with him." Within hours of the dinner party breaking up, Bross had percolated Ian's suggestions to Dulles, who next morning chaired a special group meeting to discuss a program of covert action against the Castro regime. President Eisenhower greenlit this 3 days later. Since most of the Cuba Project records were destroyed in 1967, it is impossible to connect Ian's ideas and Dulles's subsequent CIA operations by anything more than suggestion. On the 28th of January 1961, a week after his inauguration, Kennedy reviewed Dulles's plans and authorized two attempts to assassinate Castro. The Executive Action Capability, later codenamed ZR-Rifle, was not far removed from Agent 007's License to Kill, and makes it hard to disagree with the argument advanced by the American espionage fiction scholar Skip Willman that JFK's fixation on covert action to oust Castro was constituted through an underlying fantasy shaped in part by the work of Fleming. Willman says, "Fleming's pillow book fantasy undergirds the self-conception of the CIA and is what gave the CIA its identity. In dreams, that's how they saw themselves." When the 1975 Senate Select Committee studied the Bay of Pigs operation as part of an investigation into U.S. intelligence abuses, they discovered that several of the CIA's ideas overlapped with Ian's. A box of cigars laced with a depilatory to cause Castro's beard and body hair to fall out. An airdrop of lavatory paper printed with Castro's face to make him look ridiculous. Then this idea put forward by General Edward Lansdale, the overall commander of Operation Mongoose, as the campaign of subversion against Castro was known, to flood Cuba on All Souls' Day with rumours of Castro's death and the imminent Second Coming, culminating with the surfacing of a US submarine that would fill the sky with starbursts. The connections remain tenuous. Even so, it is not too much to say that Jack Kennedy's whole Cuban policy was framed in terms of Ian Fleming's fictional world. When Kennedy met William Harvey, the overweight commander of Task Force W, the CIA team that carried out the Bay of Pigs landing, the president eyed him dubiously. "So you're our James Bond?" Exasperated by Harvey's failure, Bobby Kennedy later complained, "Why can't you get things cooking like 007? It was not merely John F. Kennedy who was overly influenced by Ian Fleming's novels and engaged in secret plots. Another Bond fan was the emotionally disturbed young man who killed him. From Russia with Love was one of four Fleming titles, which Lee Oswald had borrowed from the New Orleans Public Library that summer. Kennedy saw himself as Bond, and Oswald, in a warped version, as an example of Bond's would-be assassin, Donovan Grant. Only successful, like the sniper in the window of Ian's story, The Living Daylights. "He was a reader of James Bond," explained a behavioural science professor from Mississippi in a memorandum that was sent in January 1964 to the FBI director J. Edgar Hoover. "It was inevitable that something more than target practice would be needed to consume his need to prove that he was of heroic stature. Presidential parade in Dallas presented a unique and overwhelming stimulus. In magnitude and improbability, the assassination of President Kennedy had all of the characteristics of a James Bond escapade."
When a BBC Radio 5 film critic asked listeners to name their favourite Bond villain, one person nominated Kevin McClory. Ian had spent 6 years dickering with the film industry by the time he met McClory in a private viewing theatre to watch a film that Ian's friend, Ivor Bryce, had financed and McClory directed. After his failure to penetrate the industry, this mink-coated incubus, as he called it, Ian seized on McClory as a potential guarantor of safe passage through this dangerous and slippery world. McClory suggested they make an original underwater film in the Bahamas using a widescreen camera lens. One name for their project was Bond in the Bahamas. Ian was up for it. He loved diving. He hero-worshipped Cousteau. In January 1960, Ian arrived in Jamaica after an exhausting 5-week round-the-world tour for the Sunday Times. His immediate task was to write a new Bond book. He took for his plot the storyline he had worked on with McClory and others, and for which he had submitted 2 treatments. On the 10th of March 1961, McClory was allegedly shocked to read an advance copy of Thunderball, which he maintained had used large parts of the film script. Ian landed in London to learn that McClory intended to charge him with plagiarism. It was President Kennedy's approval of Bond in America, together with the simultaneous plagiarism case against Ian in London, which combined to break the impasse that had stymied Ian's previous attempts to have a movie made. The foundations for the deal that Harry Saltzman and Cubby Broccoli signed with Ian in June 1961, leading to what Broccoli called the most successful series of movies in motion picture history, had been laid 6 months previously, when Ian agreed to give Saltzman a 6-month option as a safeguard against Kevin McClory. What Ian had struggled to achieve in 9 years, Broccoli and Saltzman accomplished in 35 minutes. On the 21st of June, a deal was struck and a budget of $950,000 was settled upon. Saltzman and Broccoli had planned to begin with the latest Bond book, Thunderball, but they opted instead for Dr. No, published in 1958, wary of McClory's ongoing legal dispute. No studio wanted to buy trouble. Ian avoided pre-production meetings. His primary concern was who would play the lead. An idea which gained momentum was to give the part to a young actor no one had heard of. Ian wrote to Bryce, "I do think the idea of creating our own James Bond from an unknown and for Xanadu, Bryce's production company, to sign him up for 10 years and have a very valuable human property on their hands is an excellent one." Since 1995, Michael G. Wilson has co-produced the Bond films with his half-sister, Broccoli's daughter, Barbara. She says, "Sean Connery was the right guy in this movie for the right time. If it hadn't been Sean, who knows? Would it have captured the attention of the whole world?" Oh, disaster, disaster, disaster. The film's director, Terence Young, had worked with Connery and was categorical in believing he was not the right guy. Connery's son, Jason, says he had worked with the teacher Yap Malmgren. He was very influential and had an acting technique, part of which was physical as well as emotional. Malmgren had advised Connery to think about large jungle cats during the interview because they are very loose. Even as Connery strode out of 2 South Audley Street following the audition, both Saltzman and Broccoli went over to the window to look at the way he walked. Broccoli said, "It was the sheer self-confidence he exuded. He walked like the most arrogant son of a gun you've ever seen, as if he owned every bit of Jermyn Street from Regent Street to St. James. That's our Bond," I said. With unconcealed relief, Ian wrote to William Stevenson on the 7th of November 1961. "The film deal with United Artists is going ahead, and they're going to film Dr. No in Jamaica in January and February." Ian had pulled some strings so that the filmmakers could shoot at Laughing Waters, a secluded beach belonging to a relation of his lover, Blanche. His wife, Anne, decided to join him at the last moment. Her friend warned her not to get overexcited. "Have you ever watched a film being made? It is the most boring thing I know. Absolutely nothing happens." To counter the boredom, she invited writer friends Peter Quennell and Stephen Spender. On the day that Bond was going to be filmed meeting Honey Rider,
Ian took Quennell and Spender down to Laughing Waters. They wandered onto the beach, only to be screamed at by director Terence Young.
"Lie down, you bastards!"
So he could film the sequence of the unknown Swiss actress Ursula Andress stepping ashore in her ivory bikini singing Underneath the Mango Tree, and Connery on the beach answering her. The composer, Monty Norman, watched Young shout at them. They were shooed off like little boys. Ian and his friends were left lying behind a dune, forgotten, until someone remembered to release them half an hour later. Not many images capture so succinctly Ian's relationship with his character. Concealed behind James Bond at every step, keeping his head low, smiling to himself, yet always there a few feet away, crouches his creator, as if half expecting to be exposed at any moment. There were no outrageous hopes for the film. Ian's favourite newspaper, The Gleaner, reported, "Dr. No promises to be a slapdash and rather regrettable picture." After the film wrapped, Sean Connery at once accepted a part in a London theatre. His photograph did not even appear in the programme. In America, few critics predicted success for a movie with a limey truck driver playing the lead. A United Artists executive told Saltzman after a New York viewing, "Well, all we can lose is $950,000. The film went on to gross 60 times its budget. As Broccoli had learned, the success and failure of a film often hangs on a question of timing. Dr. No opened in London on the 5th of October 1962, 2 days after Gaitskell addressed the Labour Party conference as Britain's likely next Prime Minister. The Beatles released their debut single, Love Me Do, on the same day. The Cuban Missile Crisis erupted 2 weeks later. President Kennedy ordered a naval blockade, demanding that Castro return the missiles already on the island to Russia. It felt like the plot of the film. The world was imitating Bond. A hostile premature review in Izvestia confirmed how seriously the Soviet authorities regarded Fleming's influence on Kennedy. Following JFK's endorsement of Bond, Russia's condemnation, and the massive sales of books, nearing a million every 2 months in America, manufacturers thronged to have their products associated with 007. In America, Colgate-Palmolive offered a line of 007 toothpaste and shaving cream. In Australia, a 007 snorkel. In Paris's Galerie Lafayette, women could buy Become Fit for James Bond lingerie, a Margaret 007 bra. Success, though, had failed to live up to the dream. When Ian's publisher informed him that he had won a replica of a 2nd century BC statue of Pan plated with 18-carat gold for having sold a million copies, "Poor man, you are now due to receive 8. It was as if Ian had become the girl in Goldfinger, coated with gold so that he could not breathe. Like Bond, he had asked, and it had been given. He had made his wish, and the wish had not only been granted, it had been stuffed down his throat. At the premiere of Dr. No, Ian had tried to take his heart pills without anyone seeing. The premiere of the second Bond film, From Russia with Love, also was not a happy occasion. Ian was awfully ill. It was a terrible ordeal for him to sign autographs, and for me to try to rescue him from the fans. Anne had arranged for his doctor to be in the audience in case anything happened. Ian enjoyed the limelight, but hated crowds. The queues formed all day round and round Leicester Square. He wrote to Amherst Villas, keen for the artist to know that the whole of England was plastered with reproductions of your portrait, and the doom-fraught eyes you gave me gazed out of practically every bookshop in the land. That fateful portrait was too near the bone. When the film was over, Clarissa Eden observed, he got up like an old man, pale grey in the face, sweat beading his forehead, swallowing pills, and apparently in a daze. Fewer than 20 mourners were present in Ian's parish church on the 15th of August 1964 to experience his funeral start and then start all over again from the beginning when Anne arrived late. I only really remember the horror of the vicar restarting the service, says Elizabeth Fleming. It just seems such a sad and lonely farewell for a fascinating man. The contrast could not have been greater to Ian's memorial service in London in September. The Times did not have space to record every name. So many prominent men and women were packed into St. Bartholomew the Great. William Plomer gave the address. He had edited all of Ian's books. Plomer began by saying how Ian had recreated in Bond a thoroughly romantic myth for the modern age, a necessary escape valve for a post-war generation hammered by austerity. But Plomer emphasised to the congregation leaning forward in their seats to catch his words, because it may not be fully understood, even among those who knew him or thought they knew him, that Ian's enormous popular success was not his best claim to fame. Instead, it was Ian's valuable wartime services long before he began to write his first book that deserved to be commemorated, and which established Ian, in a memorable phrase of Admiral Godfrey, as a war winner. And it was Ian's work in the war and the work of those like him that made it possible for us to survive and to be here together indulging in reminiscence today. In October 2021, Eon Productions released the 27th Bond film, No Time to Die, to a record number of 772 cinemas. Its co-producer, Barbara Broccoli, attributes the endurance of the franchise to Ian's war work. Bond is a distillation of the heroism of Britain that Fleming saw at that time, Britain's finest hour. And we've extended Britain's finest hour over 60 years because of him. Nor is 007 yet ready to hand in his license. King Charles III has since succeeded Queen Elizabeth II, but James Bond is still there, still flourishing, still adapting. Infinitely malleable, eternally refreshable, with his latest dialogue and behaviour contemporised by Phoebe Waller-Bridge, James Bond is the mythical hero who not only never dies, but who goes on getting livelier. Over 100 million copies of Bond novels have been sold throughout the world. Much in the same way, Bond's, and so Fleming's, influence on Britain's Foreign Intelligence Service has persisted. It indicates something about Ian's enduring impact on SIS that his intelligence gathering unit has come out of retirement. Disbanded in 1945, 30AU was revived on the 13th of December 2010 in Plymouth as the 30 Commando Information Exploitation Group, with 30AU's old motto, "Attain by surprise."